Welcome to System Devices 1, Week 1 Review, what you should know end of Week 1. So as always, the main ones are the lab and the exercise sheet, so make sure you've worked through those. So at the start of each online tech support session, I'll give an overview of what you should take away from each lab. So what are the key points? So I just want to refresh those ones now. So as previously chatted, System Devices 1 is the same as Software 1. So with Software 1, you can either program or you can't. So you can't kind of cram at the end or memorize particular facts about the Python or Java programming languages to pass the Software 1 exam, similar for System Devices 1. So yes, System Devices 1 is based on basic logic gates and Boolean representations and fundamental computer architecture stuff. But the key point here to emphasize is that you take these skills, this knowledge, and then apply it in the construction of a processor. And we do that via the Xilinx IRC tool. So that's what I'm introducing in this first lab in week one. So typically you'll be using the Xilinx tools either on the VDS or your local VM, and you'll be drawing schematics. So the first one we draw is a simple AND gate and a NOT gate. And then we'll test that up using iSIM. And that's the key one I want to kind of emphasize here, this kind of workflow. And that's what you'll be using in the open assessment. So in the open assessment, obviously you'll be building your own processor and then you'll be testing it to perform particular tasks. And you'll need to modify schematics and obviously test that those schematics are working correctly via the simulation. So we've got a series of labs to allow you to build up those skills to allow you to do that open assessment. So early days, but yes, do get used to Xilinx IRC tools. This is the main bit of software we'll be using. So do make sure you can draw those schematics, you understand what those test bunches are doing, and you understand how those similar traces show that that circuit is working. So you understand the magical green squiggles. If we're in the lab, you would have downloaded, but obviously we've got online. So we've got the virtual bug trap. It allows you to get kind of a visual view of what you would have seen in the labs. Okay, and finally in this lab, we looked at some SPICE simulations, and that allows you to view the types of signals you would have seen on the scopes, the digital test equipment in the lab, if we actually were in the lab. So SPICE, again, is another simulation language, but rather than simulating the raw ones and zeros, the bit flips that you can see in the iSIM simulations, so the logical ones, logical zeros that are being transmitted by your logical gates, it allows you to simulate the raw analog voltages now, so we can start to look at how we represent the logical ones and logical zeros on the actual wires that are inside our FPGA, inside our system. So we've got different SPICE simulation models. We've got an inverter and a noise circuit, and basically we're simulating this simple circuit here. So a single inverter driven by a signal source, so a square wave, and looking what its output looks like on its load. So initially, obviously, the first thing you see, it looks very similar to iSIM, nice and square waveforms there. But that's because we're not zoomed in enough at the moment. So if you look through this one, you'll see that if we actually zoom in on those transitions, you can see there's a fall time. So it takes some time to go from logical one, logical zero, and some rise time to go from a logical zero to logical one on the output. So it starts to introduce some terminology. So working through this one, you should be comfortable with the terminology of obviously frequency, period, duty cycle, on time, off time, rise time, fall time, what voltage levels you use to represent a logical zero, logical one, those kind of ideas. And that's what this all takes you through. As we'll use these ideas to discuss the limitations of your processor, why will it only work at a certain speed? What determines the processor's clock speed, for example? Okay, and then finally, we look at one of the advantages of working in a binary system, and that's noise immunity. So if going through this one, you can see, so even though we have a horrible signal, a very noisy signal, our system can survive that, can tolerate a certain amount of interference. Okay, so that is the end of lab one. The next key testing point for you is the workshops or the exercise sheets, should I say. And this tests your understanding of the lecture material. So this one here, week one, we're looking at number bases. So can you convert from decimal to base 2, base 4, base 8, base 16, whatever it may be. And the other way around, from base 16, 8, 4 or 2 into decimal. Then we looked at logical gates. So the truth tables for AND gate, OR gate, exclusive OR may be familiar, but do you recognize the electrical symbols that we'll be using to construct our circuits? So AND gates and OR gates, as you can kind of see here. And a little bit of Boolean minimization. So have you got kind of those basic skills in your head at the moment about how various signals will interact with each other? So what happens if you OR something with a 0 or 1 or AND something with a 0 and 1? What will the resultant be? Now, all this, I would say, is classic bookwork stuff. So in the next section, we start to look about how we can take those ideas, those core skills, and apply them to a real-world problem. So for here, we're going to build our robot cockroach. So now we're going to start to think how we can use those Boolean logic gates to control real world things. And for the first one we're going to look at is for an H-bridge. So for our robot, it has got two motors, and we want to control those to steer our robot around its environment. So if both motors go forwards, obviously the robot will move forwards. If they both go backwards, it go backwards. And if they turn in different directions, the robot will rotate on the spot, either clockwise or anti-clockwise. Now, to control our motor, we're using H-bridge. So as in the lectures, we talked about transistors, so MOSFET transistors, so metal oxide semiconductors. So here we've got different types. So we've got P-types and N-types. So remember, arrow coming out of our transistor symbol means it's P-type. So normally turned on, turns off when you put a logical one on its gate. And N-type, the opposite. So it's normally turned off, but it'll turn on if you put a logical one on its gate input. So by turning on the right pair of transistors, we can make the robot turn left or right. So if we apply a positive voltage on one side of the motor here and a 0 volts on the other side, it will rotate in one direction. And if we reverse that voltage, so now we put a positive voltage on the opposite side and connect the other side to 0 volts, it will rotate in the other direction. So we can make the robot go forwards or backwards or rotate on the spot. And we want to do that via a block of logic. So again, we're abstracting away from this H-bridge circuit to a control code. And then we do exactly the same obviously inside the processor. So when we have an instruction coming into the machine, we want to decode that to generate the control signals that will control our various architectural units. So the ALU, arithmetic and logic unit, or various memory elements inside our processor. So we're doing the same here. So here is a list of the various control signals we need to generate on our A, B, C and D outputs. So A, B, C and D. But we want to control those using a 2-bit control code. So we've got cuttle 1 and cuttle 0. So control signal 1 and control signal 0. So we assign each of those control signal states a movement. So 0, 0 is freewheel, 0, 1 is clockwise, 1, 0 is anti-clockwise, and 1, 1 is brake. And each one of those needs to be decoded into those control signals. So that is your first task here to do. So with this control circuit here, we can only turn the motor on full power, which may not be that useful. We want to kind of slow down that speed of that motor. To slow down the speed of the motor, we need to reduce its voltage across it. So at the moment, we can only switch across 5 volts, so it's either 5 volts or nothing, which may be a little bit too fast. So one way to get a lower voltage is to use pulse width modulation. And you see that exact technique used in your computer, your PC power supply. So you'll see you've got a switch mode power supply rather than a linear power supply. And the way that works is that you basically turn the power rail on and off using a variable duty cycle. So you can see here, if this was the control signal to our motor, it's on for a little amount of time and off for a longer amount of time. So the average voltage across it would be quite low. Here we've got 50-50, so it's on for 50% of the time and off for 50% of the time. So you'd see across the motor an average of half the voltage. So in this case here, the max is 5, so the half of that, it'd be 2.5. So for this one here, you can see it's mostly on and only a little bit off. So again, the average voltage will be higher. So because the motor has an averaging effect, obviously it has a latency, it can only respond so quickly. If we do this quickly enough, we'll see that the average speed of the motor will slow up and speed down as we alter the duty cycle, the on time to off time. So finally, this is our final circuit. So this control logic here is what you generated previously as defined by its truth table in figure 5. Now we want to integrate in this variable speed control signal, and that's what's coming in here. So what logic gates do I need to add to my system to control that motor appropriately? So do have a look at that one. As always, the answers will appear on the VLE. So this may seem like a little bit of a distraction away from our processor, but what I'm trying to do by going through these real-world case studies is to change the way you're thinking. So up to this point here, you're probably used to building logical gates, but what I want you now to focus on is how can I use that functionality to build practical circuits? And we'll be doing exactly the same process when we design our processor. So we'll have a specification of what our processor should do. Then I have to stop and think about how I can build all those components to actually implement its functionality. And it's exactly the same process as we're going through here with our robot cockroach. Okay, to wrap this one up, I really wanted just to emphasize what you should be focusing on. So System Devices 1 is a practical course, as I discussed in the overview on the opening lecture. So do make sure you're happy with ISE, you're happy using those tools, and you're happy to draw and test out those schematics. And you'll see that in this week's material. There's extra private study exercises that allow you to look at different circuits and see how they work and simulate them. So please do take this opportunity to have a go at those private study exercises. Okay, I think that's where I'll leave it here, and I'll talk to you in the next lecture.